The Fan.
Noon, final hour. Nordo in for PA. PA returns on Monday. And joining me now, hopefully on Monday morning, we're talking about some form of meatloaf. How good would meatloaf be if the Twins take 2 of 3 from the Angels? Joining me now, Dan Hayes of The Athletic, at Dan Hayes MLB. How you doing, Dan?
I'm good. Thanks for having me on.
No, thanks for joining me. And I want to start here. This is going to be a little bit shorter segment. Then I'm going to hang up on you, call you back, and we'll do another segment. But Twins baseball around the corner, day off yesterday. They are at the Angels, at Ohtani, at Trout this evening. But I want to go backwards first. This base is loaded thing, Dan. I mean, it's almost, I don't know, you know, you're a numbers guy. Analytics is a massive part of understanding the game, the strategy surrounding it, and all of that. But we're starting to get to a point where it's more difficult to do what the Twins are doing with the bases loaded than it is to get the bases loaded. And it's kind of head scratching here, Dan.
Yeah. I mean, it's crazy because the approaches have been good going, like, to get the bases loaded. Think about how difficult that is. I mean, you know, there's especially bases loaded with no outs. The idea that they have been able to do that 10 times is pretty good. What's happened at that point? Pretty bad. It's been, I don't even know, like, it's confounding when you think about it. I mean, they're 5-for-40 with the bases loaded this season. They're 0-for-7 with the bases loaded and no outs. And they have scored 3 runs in those situations with the bases loaded and no outs. I think a sack fly, maybe 2 sack bunts, something like that. But the fact that they don't have a hit, you know, and I've seen the name come up a couple times, So I'm on my feed the last couple of days, Pat Tabler, 80s legend at the bases loaded, somewhere like a 570 career batting average with the bases loaded. And the Twins, on the other hand, are hitting 125 this season with the bases loaded. It's confounding. It's just, you know, this is an offense that has been better than average. Overall, I think they're around 10th or 11th in runs scored. So, you know, out of 30 teams, that's pretty good. But there's been potential for so much more. And when you see them with the 24-20 record, the Twins have played a tough schedule. They've actually handled a really tough portion of their schedule extremely well. But, you know, you'd think if they'd been better offensively in these spots, maybe they're 28 and, you know, 16 or something like that and really running away with the division. And instead, they're playing well and they're cruising in a bad division right now, but it could obviously be much better. And it was funny. Rocco came up with he didn't even wait for a question to be asked before he volunteered that he just doesn't know what's going on with the bases loaded. The other day was tough. You saw really good hitters expanding their zones, which is not, I mean, Jorge Polanco was expanding his strike zone, and he is a very good patient hitter who can do a lot of stuff with a lot of different types of pitches. And when you see that even he is struggling in those situations, it tells you it's a weird rut the Twins are in right now.
Hey, let me ask you something stupid then. So you mentioned, you know, Twins somewhere Major League Baseball wide, you know, let's say they're 10th or 11th, maybe they're 9th in runs scored. So is this more or less a function of them relying, just not being able to string together enough hits, where Gallo's hitting home runs? We saw it in that final Dodgers game where you get the 1-0 deficit, you get the home run to get it back. You get the 2-1 deficit, Gallo hits top of 6 before the bases loaded fiasco began. Is it a function where we're getting those home runs and we're just not able to consistently put guys on the base paths to score runs otherwise?
Oh, I mean, the fact that they're able to load the bases would suggest that they are able to get those guys on. I mean, you know what I mean? Like,
or just not getting the RBI hits, because in the end, where you have a team with that is scoring runs, but their team batting average would be bottom five or six in the league. It's like we're getting it. We're either getting it over the fence, or once guys get on base, we're just unable to hit them in.
I mean, that has to do with organizational philosophy. I think they've been on record as saying that they like their guy. They look at offense as akin to the NBA and hitting three pointers. Three pointers are more valuable. They want their guys to do damage. They're not looking, it's clear they don't have a bunch of guys who are really singles hitters. You look throughout that lineup, there are some patient guys. Alex Kirilloff and Polanco are some guys that don't mind, you know, using the entire field and settling for singles, but also they can both do a lot of damage. Polanco hit 33 homers 2 years ago. And Kirilloff clearly has power, but you know, it's possible that's just a function of what they are, is a group that looks to hit the ball hard. And that's where they've been as a philosophy for a while. It's definitely, I think the game in general has gone that way, because the Twins are very satisfied with slug as a whole, as an important stat. And so it's possible that's the case, but at the same time, you know, I think they do pretty well at getting guys on. And the fact that they're scoring this many runs is indicative of a good offense. And, you know, when you consider that Carlos Correa has really not done much at all so far, he's had a very bad start to the season. It should be encouraging where they have been, because they've done a good job. You know, they go in these ruts where a week at a time, they're not very good. Obviously we've seen that twice so far this season, or maybe even three times, but they have good stretches where they're scoring seven runs a game for a week and a half. And currently they're in one of those. I mean, you look at what they've done against good pitching, and they have really, I think their strength of schedule is fifth in the American League. They've played a very tough part of the schedule already. So, you know, there should be days ahead where they get even fatter offensively, just because they're going to face lesser pitching staffs along the way. But it's weird. It's hard to explain what's going on. You know, it would be great if they had a Luis Arraez in there in some of these situations, but at the same time, you know, they have a lot there, and I think there's more potential coming, just because Correa can't be this bad as for the rest of the season. Royce Lewis should be back here in a couple of weeks. You know, there's just a lot of good things that the bases loaded struggles, as frustrating as they are, I think that it's something that a team-wide rut that they can figure a way out of.
I dig that. Let's pause there, Dan. I'm going to bring you back. I do want to touch on Correa, because a sample size game has now become quarter of the season game. And as you mentioned, if it can't get worse, that means it has to get better. And therefore, like you said, some positive things are in the mix. I'm going to talk to you in about 5 minutes. All right, Dan?
Sounds good.
All right. Thanks, man. That's Dan Hayes of The Athletic, theathletic.com. Follow him at Dan Hayes MLB on Twitter. When we return, I do want to dig into Correa. Buxton kind of quietly having his own issues offensively. The team doesn't steal bases, but somehow they're first place in the division. And there is interesting upside to what we're watching from the Twins. So we're going to pause. Another segment with Dan Hayes around the corner. Final.
KFAN, The Fan.
Welcome back. 9 to noon, Minnesota Twins at the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim. Anaheim, California. Beautiful. It's sunny. But back here in Minneapolis, we're chatting with Dan Hayes of The Athletic, theathletic.com, at Dan Hayes MLB. Hey, Dan, before we get to what we were talking about at the end of the last segment, how many times, whether it's a mailbag, it's a gamer, it's a piece you put up on The Athletic, and people pay for their subscriptions. I'm sure the commentary is at least, I would say, maybe a bit more educated than it might be in the midst of Twitter and other forms of social gatherings and commentary. But how many times are you asked on a daily basis, why is Emilio Pagan still on this team?
Wait a minute. I think you probably would be, like, you could just say, how many times in conversation with Aaron Gleeman do I get asked that question? Because it doesn't, yeah, it's hard to, it's tough. I mean, it's something that is always brought up. And I mean, like, look, when he's pitching in the role he was in before, that's acceptable, I think. Until the other day, he was in low leverage situations. The leverage index tells you where baseline is one, right? That's an average to high spot. Anything above one means it's a more important spot in the game. His leverage index going into that day was 0.81, meaning he is largely pitched in non-consequential spots all season long. And with the exception of that White Sox 12-inning victory where he was kind of forced into action and got the win, and that one actually heavily skewed his numbers. So he was 0.81 going into Wednesday for the season, and that White Sox game was like a 4+. So realistically, we're talking about a guy who's pitched in extremely low consequence spots, mostly pitching with the team losing or blowing out the other team and up big, rarely in a spot where he could protect the lead. And he was fine in that. Like, he actually had good numbers. I thought he had pitched pretty well. You know, I think his last like 11 outings or something like that, or maybe it was 10, he had 11 strikeouts, 2 walks, a 0.96 ERA and 9 2/3 innings. That's great. You know, you can accept that. The problem is that when he has pitched in spots with runners on trying to protect the lead like the other day, you go back to that same exact emotion that was experienced far too often last year. And so it is troubling when you think, all right, what's he doing if he can't be trusted to protect leads? You know, he's getting paid $3.5 million right now. I think there was hope that he would be able to build up and become a guy they could trust again, even if it was the seventh inning or the sixth inning. I don't know that that's there. And, you know, when you think about that, if he's a guy that is not going to pitch big spots for you, and that you can only trust him in bad spots, a lot of guys can do that, you know. And yes, he has really good stuff. He does. He has an elite stuff. But at the same time, I think that trust is important because they were in a spot the other day. Brock Stewart, who has just had this crazy rise on the ladder already because of opportunity, and Griffin Jacks, those guys were both down because they pitched too much, and the Twins needed to bridge and get there to Jorge Lopez and Yoan Duran to close out the last two. And they weren't going to use those guys for more than an inning because both had pitched multi-inning games on Monday. And so they were very clear that they wanted to use them, but it was going to be an inning at a time. They needed basically one out. You know, Jose De Leon got the 5, looked really sharp, but then started to run out of a little bit of gas. And so they went to Pagan, and it was a disaster. And, you know, you could just – that balloon popped the way it did so many times last year. And it's tough because they're in a spot where they really don't have a ton of options in the minors to go with. Jorge Alcala's hurt. You know, it's not a – the forearm injury is not – they're saying it's not something that's going to lead to Tommy John. It's on the top side of the forearm as opposed to the bottom where you're worried about elbow surgery. But he's still not on track right now. A couple other guys that they had late in camp, you know, they could really use Danny Coulomb right now. The Orioles took him away. He had a clause in his contract that essentially made him like a Rule 5, where if the Twins weren't going to keep him on their roster and another team said they would make him a major leaguer, he could be, I think it's called like an ascension clause, something like that. They could absolutely use Danny Coulomb right now. Jeff Hoffman opted out at the end. He was another veteran guy, sort of like Brock Stewart, who I think they thought was going to potentially stick around and they could stash him at AAA. And, you know, that he's now, I think, with the Phillies. You know, they're short on the options that they need.
Yeah.
Because Pagan, you know, it's a rough spot that he's there. And they're sort of forced in with him until some other young guys step up.
So I have a friend in Waconia. Her name's Carrie. Now, she has, some would consider it healthy. I would consider it an unhealthy obsession with Carlos Correa. So I don't know if she's listening now, but she's got the jersey. I mean, she's bought in on Carlos, just like we all are and probably should be. But right now, this 203 thing, Dan, it ain't working. So a couple of minutes left here. Can you help Carrie find some sanity with what's going on with Mr. Correa and get these bats working the right direction for our favorite hometown nine?
Yeah. It's not a physical thing. He's healthy. He's mobile. They're not concerned about that at all. This is clearly something else. And the approach, it just seems like way too often he is not getting the fastball. And I know the numbers bear that. We've seen him way too many times probably looking to stay alive on an off-speed pitch away by fouling it off and getting beat by a fastball inside. And it's just a little off right now. And he's talked about quite a few things for why it's happening. It's definitely frustrating. You can sense it that he is, but he also thinks and always believes that he is going to get out of it. And I think that's worth a lot more than anybody can really put their finger on. The guy just knows. Last year, he was in a free agent drive year, and he switched swings in April, May. Nobody does that. He overhauled his swing during the season with David Popkins. That is on the level of ballsiness. I would say that's about one of the most insane things I've ever heard someone do. I would say that's like an 8 out of 10 as far as taking a shot on yourself. And he turned it around, and his end of his season was amazing. And I think when you know that, and you know a guy can think he might be walking away, like look at Joey Gallo in his season last year. Joey Gallo was projecting before he got traded to the Yankees in 2021 to be a $200 million player. Joey Gallo had to settle for $11 million because he had 1.5 of the worst seasons, you know, in the last 20 years offensively. Carlos Correa could have done the same thing. And he was willing to take the risk on himself and overhaul the swing, and he did it. And I just think when you have that kind of, resume, I feel like anything can turn around. So needs to happen sooner than later, though, man. You know, it's just not been pretty so far. He's got a few big hits here and there. You know, the game winner against the Yankees at Yankee Stadium, and the other day against the Padres. His numbers, you know, slugging wise, still are okay, but it's just not been very good overall. But I do think it's going to turn.
Absolutely, thank you. Hopefully this weekend, terrific work as always covering the Minnesota Twins. Appreciate what you do for The Athletic, and we'll catch up again soon, all right?
All right, great in order. Thanks for having me on, man.
Thank you. That's Dan Hayes, The Athletic, and follow him as just do it right now, at Dan Hayes MLB on Twitter, and he's got you covered into this Angels series starting tonight. Feels like about, I think, an 8:40-ish first pitch. And it'll be Joe Ryan on the mound. You're going to get to see Ohtani and Trout, oh my, and hopefully some Twins victories. Final segment around the corner, some emails, some texts, and some bird noises. Yeah, that's the final segment around the corner, including some Tractor Talkbacks.
It's Stay Connected to the Fan.
Final segment, Nordo in for PA. Happy Friday to all of you, specifically those listening to The Fan on the farm via the free iHeartRadio app. And PA, by the way, returning into the mix during, he'll be here on Monday as we sit here. Was that bird noises? Doesn't that sound serene? Doesn't that sound, as we would say during Vikings training camp, we don't even have to do the shows anymore. We can just play this in the background. And actually, to simulate Twin Cities Orthopedics Performance Center, we'd have to get Nat sound near an airport so you can hear the planes constantly flying overhead as well, as you hear during every Vikings.
I always love that one.
Press conference outdoors. This was brought up during News du Nord, the PGA Championship taking place. And one of my buddies that I've met during my time here at The Fan, Officer Geis, Eden Prairie's finest, through his, I would say, dogged investigative research and a keen ear, he called me exasperated yesterday, feeling like he had been lied to, that he had been cheated, because he was 100% sure that those running the broadcast for the golf tournament this weekend, that they were piping in fake bird noise.
Oh, my gosh. Above average.
This does kind of sound nice, right? But this isn't happening all day. This doesn't happen from sun up to sundown. That's not how nature works. We've been cheated. We have been lied to. Officer Geis was right. So I get this text message. I got a couple of them, actually. This is from Johnny's and Joe's, not X's and O's guy, Tommy. A couple of decades back, CBS admitted piping in bird chirping. You frauds at the Masters. And this is what... So over the course of time, Brett, have you ever seen where... And I can't... There was a super prominent one with Dustin Johnson. I think he grounded his club in what was normally a sand trap, so it was a hazard. But he grounded his club there. It had been walked over the course of 3 days, and there was no remnants really of it left. But he grounds his club. That's a penalty. And somebody watching at home in HD actually calls in, and I forget, I think it may have been a U.S. Open. I don't remember for sure. That's what the text line is for, is so that I say these things top of head, and then you remind me, educate me. You are the listeners. You are smarter than me. No doubt about that. But he's penalized a stroke because someone, well, and then I think part of it was he had signed his card, too. So you have to make sure your card's accurate. So that's super negative. If you sign your card after your round and you're assessed a penalty like this later. So it's become a thing in golf periodically where, you know, someone's trying to mark their ball on the green, but it moved just a little bit. And you didn't catch it live, blind eye, but you caught it at home in HD.
And John and Eden Prairie caught it.
Correct. Just like Officer Geis is catching this piped in bird noise. But back to the text, he notes a bird expert. Even put it in there, by the way. An ornithologist,
whoa,
in fact, identified the bird call and realized that this bird was not native to Augusta, Georgia. He says they were busted and then had to admit to their chicanery. An ornithologist. Now, if you see my guy PA on a park bench wearing a trench coat and he has binoculars and he refers to himself as an ornithologist.
No!
Not the case. But in this case,
I always love that one.
A bird expert calls in and calls CBS on their BS. And then I got another text from, what a name, by the way, Dumpster Chicken Guy in North Dakota.
Okay.
And he pointed us to a comedy bit. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Ryan Reagan?
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's hear what he has to say about golf tournaments piping in bird noise.
I like watching golf on TV, and I read recently, this is true, NBC Sports, on their golf telecast, they got caught putting in bird noises for ambiance. The birds aren't even there. And a bird lover called him on it because he was hearing a bird that was not indigenous to where the tournament was being held. Wow. Can you imagine being the guy who had to field that phone call? Yeah, sports department. Yeah, hi. Listen, does this sound right to you? No, that don't. I don't know what you're talking about. Yeah, apparently you don't. Yeah, I guess I'm supposed to believe the blue-breasted whippoorwillow has decided to alter its annual migratory route to enjoy a little golf. What?
Brian Reagan, maybe talking about the same thing as Tommy. It's ridiculous. Just show us the golf, please. But it proves that viewers, you can't fool these people. You couldn't fool Officer Geis, and you couldn't fool some ornithologist watching the Masters. Getting to some tractor talkbacks momentarily, thanks to Busch Light. One of you on a Friday is going to walk away with a Busch Light prize pack and $150 to fill that fridge with Busch Light. Brett has compiled some finalists. We'll do that in a moment. But back to the text line as well. To the Vikings. During the opening segment, We're sitting here with projections. We're sitting here with the 2023 draft class. Had Alec Lewis in studio yesterday projecting what a Dwayne McBride, for instance, the UAB cat, late round pick, maybe our version of Isaiah Pacheco, what that looks like in the run game. And I had found this, and this wasn't about, I think Cynthia Freeland does good work on NFL.com, but I just read the story and I'm just thinking to myself, you take all the emotion out of it, you drill these players and these offenses down to just numbers and stats and analytics, and by win share, how does the Vikings offense stack up? And I think during that article that I had, she put the Vikings somewhere in 12th in terms of per win share, what this offense looks like. Kirk Cousins year two with Kevin O'Connell, Justin Jefferson, TJ Hawkinson, KJ Osborne, and Jordan Addison. Running back to be determined. But you're running through things and you're thinking, okay, you know, Lamar just got that money from the Ravens. They got a new OC. They're going to run the hell out of the ball. They got Odell Beckham Jr. So that coming off of now such an amount of time away, how much of a projection is that? He's 30 years old now, but certainly highly skilled. They drafted Zay Flowers, so they're trying to give Lamar options not named Mark Andrews. So they were eighth. And the Jets, now just simply enough, by adding Aaron Rodgers, that he's going to make that offensive line more competent. He's going to give them extra time. Nobody improves their offensive line more than Aaron Rodgers. And so the Jets, of all teams, magically dropping into that 10 spot and pushing your purple out of the mix. A team that was eighth in points a year ago, a team that was seventh in yards. But to the text line, I found this from Chris. I saw the Vikes were rated 12th best in another review. So maybe he was looking at something similar or different. Again, this isn't about Cynthia. It's just thinking about what this offense needs to be, given how putrid our defense has been for the last three consecutive seasons. And now going into a season where we are replacing Dalvin Tomlinson with a Dean Lowry or a Kyrus Tonga. We're replacing Eric Kendricks with a Troy Reader. Or maybe Brian Asamoah gets more reps. Maybe Ivan Pace, the undrafted cat, starts his hopefully long and storied career as a breakout undrafted cat getting reps in the NFL his rookie season. This offense needs to be top 10 for this season to be anything more than a disappointment, because things are going to get ugly, and they're going to get ugly early based on this schedule. But I saw this from Chris. I saw the Vikes were rated 12th best. I mentioned that. I'm always surprised when people say how great the offense was last year. The running game a mess, pass game just a bit above average. What they did do was make enough big plays when it mattered to squeak out tight wins. And I agree and disagree with some of the way that he put that. The passing game was incredibly high-end at times, but there was no complementary run game to be part of it. It was incredibly disjointed. And so whether it's win shares or we're just being rubes and we love our team, everything we talk about right now in relation to the Vikings. Next week when PA's back and we dig into OTAs, nine practices, I believe, between sometime next week and then into early June before they shut her down and we all just chill out and wait for training camp. Everything we're talking about is a projection. And what does it feel like? We felt like JJ was the biggest breakout and the game changer that he was. That's incredibly accurate. But how did the rest of it look at times? And so projecting what this thing is going to look like, that's all we can do. And it becomes kind of an evergreen circular related conversation because of a first-year head coach having, albeit a ton of success that he had, but also a lot of learning curves and growing pains along the way. Run game, we've beaten that to death. We've brought it back to life. We've beaten it to death. We brought it back to life again, specifically as it pertains to the future of Dalvin Cook. But can this be a top 10 offense? Can it be, Absolutely. But as it stands now, is it? Because to his point, some of the highlight-making plays, that catch that a Justin Jefferson makes at Buffalo, the screen pass to Dalvin in the Colts game, we had to come back from a 30-point deficit in the second half to win a game against a Colts team that ultimately picked fourth in the 2023 NFL draft. The stagnant part of the offense, the lulls of the offense. It was a new regime, new coaching staff, but a lot of that carried over from 2021. A lot of that carried over from 2020. Some of those things were consistent. And so how this thing projects, and not a lot of optimism. Holy cats. Oh, here we go. We got Vikings win 13 games last year. Dan and Mound with a terrible defense, all on the shoulders of our offense, and we got another weapon. Top eight for sure. Jordan Addison, projection. But I'm telling you, you're going to love the way this kid wins routes, the way that he runs so fluidly. Not the top-end speedster, not the high-end, again, the Tyreek Hill speed. He doesn't have that. But he's going to win routes, and he's going to gain that separation at a high level, and he's going to be doing it almost right away. That's going to be the fun part about this. Matt in New York, I think the offense can be elite, but moving on from Cook, we'll be losing a dynamic playmaker from the backfield, and I worry about their interior O-line. Yeah, that interior O-line, you and me both, buddy. If they'd keep Cook on a cheaper deal and sign, yeah, Dalton Risner, Kansas State, and I think he was drafted by the Broncos. He must be a free agent right now. I was not aware of that. I'd feel a lot better about it. That'll be a talker moving forward, too. With this cap space, what are we going to do? We got some money. We're a kid at the arcade right now. How are we going to burn this cash? Are we going to do it by re-signing JJ? Are we going to do it by adding a veteran on a one-year deal? So in some ways, that doesn't commit us beyond 2023, so we can still have that cash to make some of these re-signings work. We're going to have Hawkinson on his fifth-year option, want to get JJ deal done. What are we going to do with Kirk's money? Then you have Christian Darrisaw, who's going to be up for some cash at some point soon. Oh, yeah, by the way, number 99, Danielle Hunter, very unhappy that he's only making a $5 million salary this year. So how do you handle that? So I don't know even if we're going to be able to be in a spot to look too deeply into the free agency depths as the summer concludes. Vikings scored 7 points in their first round home playoff loss. That's not a top 10 offense. That's not the defense's fault. That was the last time they stepped on the field. That's what this text message says. Biggest game of the season. That is who they are. The inconsistency. That is who they are. Our projection. That is, unfortunately, who they are. To the tractor talkbacks. If there is a farmer in their tractor right now, you're on your tractor. You're listening to the show on a Friday, waiting for the bell to ring, the whistle to blow, slide down the back of that dinosaur and slip into the weekend. 800-320-5326. 800-320-5326. If you are in or on your tractor at this very moment. But courtesy of Busch Light, we do tractor talkbacks each and every day. Brett, I believe you have compiled some finalists. No gnat noise. See, farmers don't pipe in bird noises. No, they don't pipe in horns. They don't pipe in barnyard noises. They don't have a button bar. They're out there working. So no piped in noise, no fraudulence there. Why don't you play the first talkback for me?
Hey, Nordo. Jordan calling here from the Northland from up in Roseau, Minnesota. We got wheat in the ground, soybeans. We're shut down right now from rain from the last day, but we're looking forward to get going on some barley this weekend. You know what the barley growers say? No barley, no beer. Send your Busch Light here.
I kind of like that one. Let's hold on to that one. Let's jump to the Connecticut Water Systems hotline and check in with Chris. Chris, are you listening to the Fan on the farm?
Yes, sir.
Where are you at, and what are you planting?
Yeah, we're working on soybeans right now. Going around some wet spots today. We got some beans going in, looking to finish up this weekend.
Hell yeah, man. I'm going to put you on hold, and I appreciate you. Thanks for what you do, Chris, all right?
Heck yeah.
All right, that's Chris. Let's go to Randy in North Dakota. Randy, are you currently on the farm, Randy?
Yes, I am. I am planting wheat as we speak.
How many more hours left in the day for you?
Oh, let's see. It's just about noon. I would guess only about another 10, maybe.
Are you kidding me?
Here's like, what's, is that too early? Am I going to quit too early?
Hey, Randy, do you have
I can go later.
Hey, you don't let a guy like me try to tell you when or when not to work, all right? Hang tight just a second here. That's Randy. Oh, this is sweet. All right, Bruce, well, he's in Wisconsin, but that's okay. He's a farmer on the fan. Bruce, welcome to 9 to Noon. How you doing?
Hey, guys, I just want you to know you got a lot of fans over here. I'm disking. We're going to put some corn in the ground today, and even though we're Packer fans, we still listen to you every day while we're doing our field work.
No, I appreciate it. Do you like Dave Sinekin?
I love Dave Sinekin. Yep, good guy. But, you know, he's really green and gold. You got to look at the other perspective once in a while, too. But we really enjoy your guys' show, and thanks for thinking a lot about the farmers because it's that time of the year where everybody's busy.
Oh, hell yeah. And thank you for what you do, Bruce. And I agree that Dave Sinekin is very smug. You said it perfectly.
You guys have a good day. You got a lot of listeners over here in Wisconsin, even though you rip on us a lot. We still love you guys.
And we love you, too. It's all love. Thanks, Bruce. Take care. How about Bo? Let's go back up to Nodak. Let's go to Bo in North Dakota. What you planting? Where you at, Bo?
I'm actually digging the ground right now, digging it to make sure the air seeder has a nice seed bed to get a nice stand once it comes up.
So do you got to pick up like stones and do all of that, and you got to pave the way for a good plant, right?
Yeah, I usually just go right over them.
Okay, no,
I don't try not to get out too much. I just set the GPS and I just go.
Oh, that sounds beautiful. That's a perfect environment for some bush light potentially. I appreciate it, Bo. Take care, brother. Whew. How about that? Fans on the farm on a Friday. That is awesome. Randy in North Dakota, I don't know if you're going to end at 10, if you're going to end at midnight. That's up to you. I'm just some radio clown with no calluses on my hands. I'm a consumer, and I couldn't be more thankful. Get Randy from North Dakota's information. He's going to be our winner today. So stay on hold, Randy. Thank you to Chris in Clarksfield as well. Bo, all of you for joining 9 to Noon. Thank you so much to Dan Hayes and Kendra and Jordan Leopold as well. Thank you for listening. Program password around 1:30 today. You're going to hear me and Fallness go up against Gorg and Muss. But appreciate Bush Life for supporting the farmers out there, making it happen for the rest of us. The program mentioning that is next. Thanks for listening to The Fan. Have a great weekend.
Going to the iHeartRadio app or KFAN.com.